Big-wheeled bikes often get criticized for sluggish handling. People claim they're too long, steer like a barge, and simply aren't as fun to ride. But is this really the case? In this video, we're going to investigate how larger wheels shape a bike's handling characteristics. That's everything from stability and momentum to steering behavior and grip. If you missed part one of this series, that's where I broke down the science of big wheels and why they're faster. So start there if you'd like the complete understanding. Since wheelbase plays a major role in how a bike handles, let's start by finding out whether a 32er actually needs a longer wheelbase than a 29er. The wheelbase is the sum of the front and rear centers. You might assume the front center has to grow a lot to clear the bigger wheel, but in reality, it doesn't need to change. Going from a 29er to a 32er reduces the tire to pedal clearance by about 32 millimeters. But even compared to extra small modern cross-country bikes, you won't run into any toe overlap issues, as front center lengths have considerably grown over the years. As a result, a 32er will have no problem using the same front center length as a 29er. For the rear center, most modern cross-country bikes use a horizontal length of 430 to 440 millimeters. And the good news is that 32-inch wheels can fit within that range too, as long as we use a few clever frame design tricks. The first step is bending the seat tube so that the larger wheel can clear it. Next, we need to create space where the tire, chainring, and chainstay meet, which can be done with sculpted yokes. The cleanest solution is an elevated chainstay, which sidesteps most packaging constraints altogether. English Cycles is currently building a 32er with a 425mm rear center, shorter than almost every cross-country bike on the market. So basically, with the right design choices, a 32er can match the wheelbase of a 29er, which means we can rule that out as a handling drawback. Let's now investigate how 32-inch wheels impact ride stability. On a 32er, you sit a touch deeper between the wheels simply because your center of mass is a little lower compared to the height of the axles, assuming the bottom bracket height stays the same. This subtle shift means that at low speeds, a 32er tips from side to side a bit more slowly. As a result, it could feel slightly harder to balance in tight, slow, or highly technical sections, compared to a smaller wheeled 29er. That said, the effect is small, usually only a 1 to 3% increase in effective roll inertia. So I suspect that most riders will not even notice it. At higher speeds, the gyroscopic forces from the larger and heavier wheels increase rapidly, and they soon become a far bigger source of stability than the small change in center of mass position. Gyroscopic forces resist rotational changes, which makes the bike feel noticeably more stable at speed. In practice, this means you're less likely to be deflected off your line. You'll carry more speed over rough ground, and the bike gains a more planted feel on the trail. Numerically, a 32-inch wheel carries about 24% more angular momentum than a 29-inch wheel at the same speed. You'll start to notice this somewhere between 10 and 20 kilometers per hour. And at higher speeds, the 32er begins to feel more and more like a steamroller as the angular momentum gap grows. The downside is that this extra high-speed stability comes with reduced agility. Leaning the bike requires more rider input. Whether that's a positive or negative depends on the speed at which you're cornering, how tight your trails are, and whether you prefer a more playful or a more planted ride feel. Pitch stability describes how resistant your bike is to tipping forward under heavy braking or when your front wheel hits rocks, holes, or obstacles. More pitch stability means more confidence on steep descents. One way to quantify this is by looking at the endo angle on a given slope, the angle through which the bike can rotate forward before you reach the tipping point. A larger endo angle basically means it's harder to go over the bars. Because the axles sit higher relative to your center of mass on a 32er, the endo angle increases by about 1 degree, which is similar to adding around 30 millimeters of front center to a 29er. That's a meaningful bump in pitch stability without altering the wheelbase. In short, for a given wheelbase length, bigger wheels give you noticeably better pitch stability, letting you ride steeper, more technical terrain with less risk of being pitched over the front. It's the same story at the rear of the bike, but here we call it the looping angle. This is the angle that defines how far you can tip backward before you reach the point of looping out. In practical terms, a bike with a larger looping angle can climb steeper terrain more effectively. This is because there's more weight over the front wheel, meaning it won't lift off the ground as easily, giving you better front traction when the gradient kicks up. Once again, because the axles sit slightly higher in relation to your center of mass on a 32-inch bike, the looping angle increases by about 1 degree. To get that same level of anti-looping stability on a 29er, you'd need to lengthen the chainstays by around 18 millimeters. So just like up front, the bigger wheels give you more climbing stability without altering the bike's wheelbase length. The downside of a larger looping angle is that it becomes a bit harder to pop the front wheel up. That means hopping, manualing, and clearing obstacles all require more effort. To make a 32er pop up as easily as a 29er, you'd need to shorten the chainstays by around 18 millimeters. Next, let's look at how bigger wheels hold momentum. The tires and rims aren't just bigger and heavier on a 32er. The weight also sits further from the hub. This gives them more inertia, which makes the wheels resist speed changes. In other words, the wheels are a bit harder to get moving, but once they're rolling, they don't want to slow down. This helps carry more speed over small rises and makes the bike feel more stable on rough terrain. And on rougher surfaces, that extra angular momentum can make the bike carry more speed and feel more stable because you get pinged offline by bumps much less. My calculations show that 32-inch carbon wheels and comparable tyres require around 13% more energy to spin up than their 29-inch equivalents. But because wheels are only a small fraction of the total system mass, the real-world acceleration difference is minimal. The heavier and larger 32-inch wheel also produces more gyroscopic torque, which influences steering feel. A rider can usually apply several newton meters of steering torque through the handlebars. At low speeds and with gentle steering inputs, the torque difference between wheel sizes is well below 1 newton meter, far too small for anyone to notice. At higher speeds or during rapid steering, a 32-inch wheel adds roughly 1 or 2 newton meters of extra torque at the bars compared to a 29er. Most riders will likely perceive this not as heavier steering, but as increased high-speed stability, especially given handlebars often provide 30 to 50 newton meters of leverage. If you really wanted to counter it, adding a few centimeters of handlebar width would pretty much do the job. We can also compensate through geometry tweaks, such as changing the head angle or fork offset. And realistically, we'll need to change both of these if we want our 32ers to feel like 29ers, because the bigger wheel naturally adds more trail and more wheel flop. But we'll cover that in part 3. Let's assume that you're using identical tyres on a 29 and 32 inch wheel set. Which wheel size will achieve more grip?
Before we start, I want to make it clear. When it comes to tyre grip, the biggest factors are always going to be the tread pattern, casing construction, pressure, and rubber compound of the tyre, not factors around the wheel size itself. The only somewhat scientific test I found that compared the cornering grip of 26 and 29 inch bikes using the same tyre model and air pressure was by Mountain Bike Magazine in Germany. They used an accelerometer and speed sensor to measure the traction limit through a flat corner. The results suggested that cornering grip was identical between the two wheel sizes at equal pressures.
But the equal pressure thing might have been the problem. And here's why.
The tyre footprint is the contact area the tyre makes with the ground at any instant in time. And its size mainly depends on three factors: vertical load, casing stiffness, and air pressure. The interesting thing is that if you're running the same tyre model at the same pressure, the total contact area will be the same whether you're riding a 20-inch folding bike, a 27.5-inch plus bike, or a 700c gravel bike.
So on the surface level, the footprint should be the same for 32-inch wheels, right? Well, that's not the full story.
A better way to compare tyre performance is by looking at either the hoop stress or tyre drop, because these reflect how the tyre structure responds to internal pressure and load. When hoop stress or tyre drop is matched between bikes with different wheel sizes, the tyres ride very similarly. For tyre drop, we measure how much the tyre compresses under your weight. Because 32-inch wheels have a larger air volume, they actually need slightly less pressure to achieve the same tyre drop or hoop stress, about 1 psi lower on a 2.4-inch tyre. That reduction in pressure boosts the 32-inch wheel's contact patch by roughly 5% compared to a 29er.
So yes, the 32-inch wheels end up with a larger footprint than the 29-inch wheels when using the same tyre.
This allows a tyre to conform better to the terrain, providing more grip and more comfort. The tyre footprint shape also changes with the wheel diameter. A larger diameter wheel has a longer but narrower tyre footprint.
But the variation in shape is probably much smaller than you'd expect, or have been made to believe.
Between 29 and 32-inch wheels with 2.4-inch tyres, it's likely a 5% difference in each dimension, longer but narrower for the 32er. But when we factor in the reduction in tyre pressure needed to achieve the same tyre drop, the contact patch length grows to about 10% longer. This is nothing huge, likely 5mm more length or so, but it might just be enough additional length to engage one extra row of knobs, which means more grip relative to the 29er. Having said that, I think the bigger improvement in traction is from something else. A larger wheel is less jolted over rough terrain because, as we discussed in part one, the angle of attack is reduced. This allows the 32er to maintain a more consistent grip when the trail is loose or bumpy.
And lastly, we need to look at cornering traction.
Cornering traction really comes down to how a tyre spreads sideways forces into the ground. With the 32-inch wheel, the contact patch is about 10% longer. That extra length means the tyre distorts less, and each tread block shears less under load, which boosts cornering stiffness and reduces the slip angle needed to make grip. At the same lean angle on the trail, a 32er is simply operating further from its traction limit than a 29er, which means you can lean a few more degrees before the tyre begins to drift sideways under load.
Kinematic modelling suggests a 10 to 12% bump in usable cornering grip.
And you'll feel that most on loose over hardpack and off-camber sections where every bit of extra bite matters. In summary, if your trails are fast, rough, or open, a 32er plays to its strengths. More stability, more traction, more momentum, and more confidence on steep terrain. If your riding is tight, twisty, or playful, a 29er still feels more responsive and easier to flick around. Ultimately, the right choice comes down to your trails and your riding style. If you haven't seen the first episode on why bigger wheels are faster, check that out next. Or stay tuned for the final episode, where we explore the design constraints of 32-inch wheel bikes. I'll see you guys soon.